Hey, hello and welcome everyone. So in this video, this will be the first of two lectures that I'll have that'll pertain in some sense to price gouging. The first lecture is going to go over this paper that I've got here, and the second lecture is going to go over Zielinski's paper. And so this will be kind of part one and part two, but I'll make it relatively self-contained, relatively standalone for these two different parts, though of course it's going to go with the same slide deck. All right, so the first paper is fairness as a constraint on profit seeking, entitlements in the market. And this is a survey, so an empirical study involving surveys, telephone surveys, of individuals' beliefs and standards of fairness on prices, wages, and different sorts of things that then give rise to how we might think about price gouging for the second lecture. The second paper is Matt Zielinski's The Ethics of Price Gouging. And basically the idea in that paper is to argue against anti-price gouging laws. So the first thing that I'm going to do, this first lecture, is I'm going to think about what are people's preferences, what are people's beliefs about fairness, as then pertains to how we judge whether there's an instance of price gouging, what price changes are fair, what changes in price are unfair. And then in the second lecture, then I'll kind of analyze. Zielinski gives kind of a good perspective, good arguments. He's a philosopher. Philosophers think really carefully about providing compelling arguments, and it's basically giving the standard mainstream economics argument against anti-price gouging laws. And so basically my goal is to be able to sort of present these arguments. It kind of raises some really interesting points. You might agree, you might disagree with Zielinski. The point is, I want you to be able to kind of think about evaluating the arguments from the use of economics. Like, if you disagree with Zielinski, well, why? What's going on? It's probably that you've got different economic assumptions. So then we want to think carefully about what those assumptions are buying for us in the model that you're applying and thinking of, and so on and so forth. And that'll be the topic for the next video. This first one now, you're staring at this date. You're like, wow. 1986. And in a lot of cases, we are coached up to kind of restrict our study of research to what's been published in the last 5 to 10 years. And there's something to be said for that perspective. You want to stay relatively current with the research. However, I think it is a grave error to eliminate past research simply on the grounds that it was published decades ago. In particular, I think this paper does a really good job, and it's kind of a brilliant paper, and that's why I included it in the course. And yeah, there's aspects from it that you're going to realize, yeah, it was published in 1986. So then we ask ourselves the question of, well, how would this look today, right? And what would happen if we do this follow-up, if we do a follow-up study? In particular, you know, this was over telephone surveys. What if it was done over the internet or something like that? Who knows? But the point is, like, I think, and there's some really important classic papers from decades ago, and I think it's just a mistake to try to eliminate our focus. Like, how do you know what we know until you know where we came from? And so it's sort of like, it's really important to go back and to think about prior research and to understand, especially if you're interested in one particular area, you want to think carefully about how the economics has developed and how thoughts amongst, researchers and, you know, people thinking carefully about these ideas have changed over time. And I think it's really important. So this paper, this is the one that we're going to focus on first, fairness as a constraint on profit seeking, entitlements in the market. So this is studying community standards of fairness for prices and wages via telephone surveys. The basic idea is they're going to try to elicit people's judgments in terms of whether or not a particular scenario is going to be, or a particular price change or wage change given in a vignette in a particular scenario is going to be acceptable or is going to be unfair. Their findings were, well, in both customers, like product and service markets, or in labor markets, it's acceptable for the firm to raise prices or cut wages if their profits are threatened, and or to maintain prices when costs diminish. However, it's unfair to exploit shifts in demand by raising prices or cutting wages. Think really carefully about what this means. So if there's an increase in demand, right, or a decrease in demand, then in terms of like trying to profit or trying to profit too much, very often people are judging those responses as unfair. It's really relevant to price gouging because usually when we're thinking about price gouging, what's happened is we've got some type of disaster. We've got something that's caused a massive increase in demand, right? And then the issue would be if the seller is benefiting too greatly or at the expense of consumers by virtue of taking advantage of those circumstances. So this is precisely like what we're thinking about when we're later going to consider price gouging. All right, so the first observation, and this is just like kind of, this is like kind of a true observation kind of about how markets and prices and markets tend to persist over time. The basic idea is, well, prices and wages tend not to adjust quickly or completely, or at least not as quickly and as completely as you might expect by standard profit maximization. So economic theory predicts that prices would adjust quickly, and very often prices don't adjust quickly, especially wages. And so then the question is, why not? I mean, one quick answer is there's like transaction costs. So you think about like a restaurant reprinting menus with prices. That's one reason why prices might not change. But then there's also an appeal to fairness. So for instance, like some have appealed to fairness as an explanation why wages are not cut during recession. And so this is a really interesting observation now. Like this is one of the places like from the paper we want to kind of think about like updating to the future. So they cited this paper, which extended this observations to customer markets, finding that tickets don't rise when there's excess demand. Now, we do know in present day, there's dynamic pricing. And based on whether it's a secondary ticket market or sometimes whatever is the original vendor itself may raise or lower ticket prices, typically raise in response to which are the hot ticket items. And so, you know, there's different sports teams, there's different performers, entertainers that will have spiked prices during like the weekends or the most desirable performances or shows or games or so on and so forth. And so one thing that's interesting to reflect on is why, what's different. So maybe between 1981 and today, people's thoughts about fairness have changed in terms of especially pricing for tickets, or, you know, maybe there's something else going on back then. Maybe it just wasn't feasible to change prices as rapidly. Who knows? We can come up with a lot of reasons why it was the case that there wasn't very often changes in ticket prices in response to surges in demand, at least years ago. So what was the reasoning for why that was the case? Well, the argument was like these price increases wouldn't have been justified by an increase in costs and therefore would have been considered unfair, right? Going back to like what was one of the results from the paper actually was it's unfair to exploit shifts in demand by raising prices or cutting wages. But people judged it as relatively okay to change prices if costs changed. Well, the problem with like a surge in demand for a desirable sporting event or performance or whatever is that, well, here you've got a shift of demand and you don't have a change in costs. And so maybe people would judge that price change as unfair. And that actually one thing that I want to kind of add to this is I think the perspective really matters. I think even today, I think customers view it a lot differently. If it's the entertainer themselves or the sports franchise themselves that are raising the prices in response to like a surge in demand for a particular game or a particular night, or if it's other fans. So for instance, when I was living in Arizona, I wanted to go see the Arizona Diamondbacks and it happened that they were playing the Chicago Cubs. And so I was going to go to the game and I found out, oh, wow, that when the Cubs come to town, that is considered like a premium ticket. And so the tickets were substantially more expensive, something like, I don't know, maybe like 50% more expensive. And it was on the basis of the fact that, well, it was the Cubs. And I noticed the Phoenix Coyotes would do the same thing when Detroit Wings would come to town. And actually, one of the reasons why you can do that in Phoenix is because it's got a lot of folks who have come from the Midwest and either spend some or all of the year there. But anyway, so I didn't like that very much because that was coming from the team itself. However, if I would go and buy the ticket from another fan and the price would have been a lot higher, I guess I would have understood. And so that kind of makes sense. And so I think it's actually kind of important in the context of this discussion to recognize who is benefiting, right? So if there's a price increase, who's benefiting? Is it the firm? Is it the entity themselves? Or is it some other, is it like another individual? Or is it some third party? Or is it some charity? There's actually one of the surveys, one of the vignettes I'll talk about. People judged it substantially more fair when the proceeds would go to charity than when it would go to the store itself. Anyway, so the important argument is, well, fairness is really important to the maximization of long-run profits. So what's this paper doing? Well, using household surveys of public opinion to infer rules of fairness for conduct in markets from evaluations of particular actions by hypothetical firms, right? So what they want to do is identify community standards of fairness that apply to price, rent, and wage setting by firms under varied circumstances, and to consider the market consider the possible implications of the rules of fairness for market outcomes. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually kind of select the ones that I really want to talk about and I think are interesting to illustrate. You should go find the paper. It's an interesting paper and perfectly accessible at the advanced undergrad economic level. Okay, so the study considered a firm, and the firm could be cast as a merchant, as a landlord, as an employer, making some price or wage setting decisions. These affected the outcomes of one or more transactors who could be like customers, tenants, or employees. And the way that the survey was done was a scenario was read to participants who then evaluated the fairness of the action, rating it as completely fair, unacceptable, unfair, or very, very unfair. So actually interesting, remember, this is going to be a phone survey. So the scenario was read to participants. And you always kind of wonder, I mean, with survey experiments, survey data, there's some interesting things going on in terms of different types of experimenter bias, in terms of, well, I mean, if you're calling somebody on the phone, what's the opportunity cost of their time? Are they giving you serious answers? Are they having fun? Are they just trying to get the survey over with? So there's a lot of interesting questions. Also, apart from the issue that here the scenario is read to participants, I'm going to show you this. You'll read it for yourself. I'll read it to you as well. But you can imagine how this would be different if you only had the audio. Maybe, who knows, maybe you're not looking at the slides, and maybe that's actually your experience. All right, so here's the first one. A hardware store has been selling snow shovels for $15. The morning after a large snowstorm, the store raises the price to $20. Please rate this action completely fair, acceptable, unfair, or very unfair. Now, I want to pause for a second. When I teach this in class, I always do, and I stop for discussion amongst the students and then myself. But stop, just like kind of stop the video, think for a second. Is it fair or unfair, right? The hardware store was selling snow shovels for $15. Then there's a large snowstorm, and that morning the store raises the price to $20, right? All right, so kind of think about your own assessment there. Here's what the survey reported. Well, the first thing is how they dealt with the data. They grouped together the two fair and the two unfair selections to give a proportion of respondents indicating acceptable versus unfair. In this example question, 82% considered it unfair for the store to take advantage of a short-run increase in demand associated with a blizzard. Really important. So the authors are not trying to deal with the normative aspect of these statements. Instead, they are using "it is fair" as an abbreviation to mean a substantial majority of the population studied thinks this is fair. Interestingly, when I've done this in class, so like 82% consider this unfair, when I've done this in class, it's almost exclusively been with econ majors, and I would say it's close to 50-50. It might even be a lot of econ students end up judging this as being actually acceptable. So actually from my perspective, this particular scenario doesn't bother me as much. One sort of like variant that students have suggested in the past is they'd consider it substantially more unfair if the hardware store spiked their price when there was news of the snowstorm coming, like in the days leading up. So the idea being, like, if you're paying attention to the weather and you go and buy your snow shovel for $15, good. If you don't and it's later on, then you're going to pay $20. And, that's just how it's going to work out. There's actually kind of an interesting rationing story, right? So actually, this is a kind of a good time for me to mention this. So we're familiar with the pricing of airline tickets, right? It's kind of a common example for third-degree price discrimination. It's actually some pretty good second-degree price discrimination in there as well, because individuals are facing the same menu of prices, and people self-select into when and which ticket to buy. But anyway, so that apart, we know that ticket prices are higher as we're nearing the departure, and they're lower when you have many months or weeks in advance. The idea being those who have to fly immediately have much more inelastic demand, so will charge a higher price. And those who have more time before their intended departure have much more responsive, much more elastic demands, will give them a discount. All right, so that's kind of the standard story. And then, you know, people might think, wow, the airline is taking advantage of those who have really inelastic demand, which a lot of times people are relatively okay with it because it tends to be like business travelers and stuff like that. But it can also be people who have family emergencies or people with like unexpected pressing needs. And so one thing that I want to kind of push back on and suggest is like, well, it's not just the case that the airline is the only one benefiting from high ticket prices the day before or the day of the departure. It's also the people who are able to buy that ticket. Because so for instance, and I like to give this example in class, like flying from, so in the middle of the winter, if I could get a cheap ticket from Detroit to Phoenix and be able to spend the weekend in Phoenix when it's beautiful weather and I can go to In-N-Out Burger and I can get in some good trail running. If I could do that flight for, you know, just a couple hundred dollars, if it was pretty cheap, it's like $200, I might actually jump on that, even maybe get a cheap Southwest flight or something like that. But because the ticket price for the immediate departure, when I decide, oh, I do have a weekend free, tends to be a little bit more expensive, maybe a couple hundred or several hundred dollars, maybe $1,000, I typically don't buy that ticket because it's too expensive, which means that ticket remains for somebody who's got a pressing need to go from Detroit to Phoenix to see family or whatever is the case, instead of me just wanting to go to In-N-Out Burger, right? So there's something really important about, well, those high prices. In matter of fact, like in the snowstorm example, that $20 price might discourage somebody who just wants like a backup shovel versus like somebody who's not going to be able to, who's not going to be able to have a shovel otherwise. So anyway, that's kind of an interesting kind of aside, which is I think worth reflecting on, is who's benefiting. Well, yeah, whoever's selling the ticket for the high price, yeah, they're a primary beneficiary, but the consumers who actually get the good at that price and are willing to engage in that exchange, they benefit by virtue of being able to get the good that other people with more frivolous uses are not going to agree to. All right, so anyway, the paper considers three determinants of fairness. So the reference transaction, the outcomes to the firm and the transactors, and the occasion of the action for the firm. So I'll kind of explain each of these. The reference transaction. So there's some relevant precedent characterized by some existing price or wage, as well as some reference level of profit. So it could be like whatever is the current wage or whatever is the current price tends to stick in people's minds as being the reference point. Researchers summarize their findings by the principle of dual entitlement, governing community standards of fairness, meaning transactors have an entitlement to the terms of reference of the transaction, you know, be it price or be it wage. And the firms are entitled to their reference profit, other things equal, right? So the firm's not allowed to increase profits by violating the transactor's entitlement to the reference level, whatever, like rent in the case of if you're renting, or wage if you're a worker, or the price. However, when the reference profit of the firm is threatened, it might set new terms to protect the profits at the transactor's expense, and people might judge that as more fair. All right, so here's an example now to illustrate the role of prior history. So suppose there's a small photocopying shop with one employee who has worked in the shop for 6 months and earns $9 an hour. The business continues to be satisfactory, but a factory in the area has closed and unemployment has increased. Other small shops have now hired reliable workers at $7 an hour to perform jobs similar to those done by the photocopy shop employee. The owner of the photocopying shop reduces the employee's wage to $7. What do you think about that? Well, if you're like 83% of people, you think that's unfair. If you're like 17% of people, you think that's acceptable. Here's another sort of variation to illustrate the role of the prior history. So take the same setting, but now suppose that initial worker leaves and the owner decides to pay a replacement at $7 an hour. So now 73% of people said that's acceptable. 27% said this is unfair. Let me just go back to the original scenario, right? So previously the worker is at $9 an hour and then the employer lowers their wage to $7 an hour. Okay, that's unfair. Well, suppose that person leaves and the employer lowers that job description, that job position to $7 an hour. 73% say that's acceptable, right? So that's interesting. The current wage serves as a reference for evaluating future adjustments, but not necessarily that paid to a replacement, only within the context of the initial relationship. So the entitlement of an employee to a reference wage does not carry over to a new labor transaction, even with the same employer. This is a sample. Sorry, there's some typos in this one. This is supposed to be same, even with the same employer. All right. Good. All right, so here's another sort of prior history sort of story. A house painter employs two assistants and pays them $9 per hour. The painter decides to quit house painting and go into the business of providing landscape services, where the going wage is lower. This reduces the worker's wage to $7 per hour for landscaping work. 63% said that's acceptable. 37% said that's unfair. So, interestingly, the cardinal rule from the paper, the cardinal rule of fair behavior is surely that one person should not achieve a gain by simply imposing an equivalent loss on another. In the present paper, outcomes to the firm and transactor are defined as gains and losses in relation to some reference transaction. You want to think of think of the entitlement to whatever is the reference point, and it's not legitimate or it's not viewed as fair for the firm to be able to benefit, to gain by depriving the worker of their reference transaction, which is interesting. That kind of changed in this one, right? And I think it's obviously because the nature of the work has changed. However, 37% of people kind of feel probably like a loyalty story. Hey, you've had these same people for quite a while. They're kind of entitled to the same wage that they had before because they're continuing on with you. Maybe the 63% viewing this as acceptable are saying, hey, this is a completely different business. And or, they've got a different job description now. So, all right. So also we see naive accounting where judgments and choices diverge from standards of rationality. So people evaluate outcomes as gains and losses relative to some neutral reference point rather than the end outcomes. People are more sensitive to out of pocket costs than to opportunity costs, and more sensitive to losses than foregone gains. So these are some like interesting observations from some of this behavioral economics and mathematical psychology. So the upshot is like preferences are really vulnerable to framing effects. In particular, you can have otherwise inconsequential variations to the way that the vignette is presented, and this will affect the decision in ways that standard economic theory would predict that it wouldn't happen. So for instance, an action by the firm is more likely to be judged unfair if it causes a loss to its transactor than if it cancels or reduces a possible gain. The action by the firm is more likely to be judged unfair if it achieves a gain to the firm than if it averts a loss, right? So interesting, the action by a firm is more likely judged unfair if it causes a loss to the transactor than if it cancels or reduces a gain, right? The same net cost could be the same to the transactor. And the firm is more likely judged unfair if it gains relative to if it avoids a loss, which is interesting. All right, so here's an example. We have a company making a small profit. It's located in a community experiencing a recession with substantial unemployment but no inflation. There's many workers anxious to work at the company. The company decides to decrease wages and salaries by 7% this year. So 38% says that that's acceptable. 62% says that this is unfair. Now, this is interesting. I mean, look, so if you're a firm, you're interested in minimizing your input costs, right? Like if you find a different supplier of whatever is the input that you're trying to use to make whatever is the product that you're selling, most people would probably view that as prudent and wise to buy whatever is the cheaper input. However, when it comes to labor, people don't view it that way, right? If you've got current workers and now you've got a lot of other workers who are really interested in working here, you can't you can't reduce wages in the face of this sort of like excess labor supply. However, take the same vignette now with substantial unemployment and inflation of 12%. This company decides to increase salaries only 5% this year. 78% judge this as acceptable. 22% judge this as unfair, right? So this is a framing story, firstly. So it's a framing story. So here we have this framed as workers losing 7%. And then in this one, this is framed as workers not gaining 7%, right? Only gaining 5%. So, I mean, the same in terms of like thinking about what's actually happened to those workers, right? So it could be that the people responding didn't understand 12% inflation versus a 5% increase in salary. I don't know. But anyway, it's the same sort of outcome, right? The real income change is approximately the same. The two problems, the judgments of fairness, very different. All right, so This example, a shortage has developed for a popular model of car. Customers now have to wait 2 months for delivery. The dealer's been selling the cars at list price. Now the dealer prices the model $200 above list price. 71% view this as unfair, 29% view this as acceptable, right? I mean, this is actually, I would view this as perfectly acceptable because I would view this as pretty much like the airline example that I gave. So actually one thing that's interesting is to like update and find out what this means. So the paper was published in 1986, which means the study was actually probably done in 85 or 84. You can go back in the paper and find out exactly. But I went to check, let's just call those $200 like $500 today. And so I don't know. I mean, it's not an inconsequential amount of money. And so, and here they're basically, what's going on is people are reacting to the firm taking advantage of this increase in demand. Basically, it's a demand shift. Their cost didn't change, the demand for the product changed. And the theme from this paper has been changing prices in response to demand shifts has been judged as unfair. All right. Suppose a dealer has been selling those cars at a discount of $200, or you can think of like $500 today. Now the dealer sells the model only at list price. Oh, 58% view this as acceptable, 42% is unfair. Interestingly, people tend to react to expiring discounts, right? Expiring discounts different than price increases, right? If you change the sticker price, that tends to irritate people. But if you remove a discount, people tend to react much more favorably. People seem to think of discounts and coupons as like specials and bonuses, and they tend to ignore what's the effect on like the overall price. And so actually it's sort of a ubiquitous pricing strategy. You see like discounts and expire, like online shopping, you see like special codes. So, you know, I just registered for a Spartan trail race, and they had a code for spooky for Halloween, and it didn't work. It ended up not giving me the discount. They have these discounts, and the discounts expire. That spooky means it's like the Halloween discount, and they're not going to have that after the end of October, I would imagine. And most people are going to think that's okay. I'm going to think it's great because it didn't work for me in the first place. But anyway, people tend to react better to expiring discounts better than they do to sticker prices, right? If they change the price, of the race, I'd think of that as being much less fair. All right, so the occasions for pricing decisions matters as well. So the occasion could be protecting profits, allocating gains, exploiting increased market power. I'm going to focus on the last one. You can read in the paper. There's some other interesting things to go about, but I just want to focus on the last one here, exploiting increased market power. So think of the Blizzard example. The Blizzard increases the surplus associated with the purchase of the snow shovel at regular price. You get this increase in demand, so you get presumably increased economic surplus in the market. It could just be increase in consumer surplus if the price doesn't change, but if the price does change, then the firm captures some of that increase in surplus. And respondents viewed it as unfair for the store to capture any part of the increased surplus, saying that this would violate customers' entitlement to the reference price. Right? That gain should go to consumers. The price, whatever was the prevailing price of the shovel, $15, that's the price of the shovel. And if my desire for the shovel increases, that's not something that the firm should be able to profit from. It's something that I should profit from. So that's kind of the story here. All right. So the opposition to exploitation is not restricted to the severe circumstances. So suppose there's a shortage of Red Delicious apples developed in a community. None of the grocery stores or produce markets have any type of this apple on the shelves. Other varieties are still plentiful. One grocer receives a single shipment of Red Delicious apples at regular wholesale cost and raises the retail price of these Red Delicious apples by 25% over the regular price. 37% say that's okay. 63% say that that's unfair, right? And that's interesting. So presumably people have some reference point that they have in mind for what Red Delicious apples should sell for, and bad to increase the price, taking advantage of the fact that this shipment is now super scarce. So raising prices in response to a shortage is unfair despite the presence of close substitutes that are readily available. Now, this is in the context of the apples, where there's lots, right? We're told there's lots of other varieties that were plentiful, and people judge this as unfair for the firm to benefit by the shortage. How much more would people view it as unfair for the firm to benefit from a shortage created by natural disaster, in the case of price gouging, for instance, right? Similarly, for luxury items, the majority of respondents thought it was unfair for a popular restaurant to impose a $5 surcharge for Saturday night reservations, right? So $5, an additional charge, probably today would be, well, that's interesting. What would that be today? $5 back then would be the same as $12 today. Okay, good. So $12 surcharge for a Saturday night reservation. I mean, I don't know. You could, given that we live in a world where there's like certain premium products. I was just telling you the example of like dynamic pricing and the premium game to go see the Chicago Cubs playing the Diamondbacks, or you know, some of these other, maybe we'd expect in, you know, if there's a particular rivalry game, we might expect that those tickets are going to be priced a little bit higher. If there's a particular, we'd expect like the movie that's premiering late at night to be a more expensive ticket than one during the afternoon, and the same for like musicals or whatever type of performances. So, I mean, for me, at least, it doesn't seem too ridiculous to have a surcharge for Saturday night, even for Friday night reservations. Especially, like, I almost never, I don't remember the last time that I ate at a restaurant. And, no, that's not true. I went to Butter's, what's it called, in Scottsdale, which is my favorite breakfast place, last time I was trail running in Phoenix. That would have been, boy, that was... It was like February or something. Anyway, so I would actually kind of like this if it makes it easier for me to be able to get a table, given how rare it is for me to go out to eat. But other people might say this is completely unfair. Matter of fact, that's kind of what people expected. Here's another example. Suppose a landlord rents out a small house. When the lease is due for renewal, the landlord learns a tenant has taken a job very close to the house and therefore is unlikely to move. Landlord raises the rent $40 per month more than they are planning to do. This is like the biggest, right? This is the biggest spread. 91% viewed this as unfair. 9% is acceptable. Interestingly, this is actually built into a lot of rental pricing, right? So I know anecdotally from apartments in Chicago, right? If you have an apartment in Chicago and you're there for a year, they're going to raise your rent on you if you're in this particular complex. Why? Well, they think you probably don't want to move. They think your demand is pretty inelastic. As a matter of fact, I know of a story where a renter was able to get a pretty good discount by moving across the hall, like a little bit more than across the hall, but basically like being willing to pack up their stuff and move down the hall saved like a bunch of money because, well, kind of call, I suppose like calling the landlord's bluff in some sense. So the idea is like, it's actually pretty common that they're going to raise rates on you later on because people are creatures of habit. And the longer you've been in a place, the more likely you are to probably want to stay. And because you've got this inertia and because it's a pain to pack up and move. And so, but this is taking it to another level, I suppose, because here the landlord's exploiting information, right? Took a job close to the house, unlikely to move. And this also seems a little bit different because this is a small house. This seems to be singling out a particular renter. And if that's the case, this seems like grossly unfair. Okay. So the last one's really interesting. So a store has been sold out of the popular Cabbage Patch dolls for a month. Week before Christmas, a single doll is discovered in a storeroom. The managers know that many customers like to buy the doll. They announce over the store's public address system, doll will be sold at auction to the customer who offers the most for it. This is interesting. So I remember, this is 1986, so I remember early 80s, how big of a deal the Cabbage Patch dolls were. This is sort of, I don't know if I can like update us to the present time. There had been something called the Tickle Me Elmo that had been pretty popular. And there's probably, it's not every year, but it's probably about every 5 years or something like that. Something really catches fire and everybody wants that for holiday gift. Cabbage Patch doll was definitely it in like 1985 or whatever. I did not get one. I knew what they were, but when I was in 1985, I was really into airplanes. And then I learned that I get airsick. So I thought I was going to be a pilot, but I get airsick. And so here I am teaching economics, which is actually other things equal exactly what I want to be doing. So anyway, 26% view this as acceptable. 74% view this as unfair. Now, interestingly, adding to the statement, proceeds will go to UNICEF, a charity, right? Reduces negative judgments down to 21%, right? So it matters who's going to get this surplus. If it's the manager from the store, if it's the store is going to benefit, right? If the store is going to benefit, that seems super unfair. But if they're going to auction off and then donate the proceeds to charity, that seems much more fair. Actually, the variation that I would like is, what if like somebody had bought it, like just some, who knows if it's the manager off duty or whatever, fine. Then they go outside and they decide to sell it. I wonder if you're separating that from the, if you're separating the transaction to now between individuals versus like acting on behalf of the store, right? You think of like Target or Walmart, and you think of if you're buying from Target or buying from Walmart, there should just be like the price. But if you're buying from somebody who bought it at Walmart, that feels a little bit different. Although, right, so like if somebody uses their employee discount and then goes and turns around and sells it, well, but you wouldn't necessarily, I don't know who's you, so you might consider that as being unfair. I don't know if you hold that against the company so much as you'd hold it against that specific manager. But at the same time, here now you're able to get this toy that you wouldn't have gotten otherwise. And so there is then that argument again. Anyway, so the findings overall suggest many actions are both profitable in the short run, not obviously dishonest. Findings suggest that many actions that are both profitable and not obviously dishonest are likely to be perceived as unfair exploitations of market power. Four propositions suggested. So I'll talk about just a couple of them. So when excess demand in a customer market is unaccompanied by increase in suppliers' cost, the market will fail to clear in the short run, right? When a single supplier provides a family of goods for which there is a differential demand without corresponding variation of inputs, shortages of the most valued items will incur. This is bizarre. What was I doing? I feel like something got cut off here. This is kind of an awkward way to end the video. I'll go ahead and do that anyway. But let's see. So what were? Yeah. So basically, like we have circumstances where, yeah, you'd have some instances that are going to be profitable and not clearly dishonest, but might still be viewed as unfair exploitations of market power. So, let's see. So if there's excess demand, right, but there's not an increase in suppliers' costs, then you're going to have a shortage. That's all this means. Market fails to clear in the short run. And I guess they're saying you can't then, it's unfair for the seller to take advantage of this increase in demand since their cost didn't rise. When a single supplier provides a family of goods for which there's differential demand without corresponding variation in cost, shortages the most value. Oh, interesting. Yeah. So suppose you have a whole collection of goods and there's different demand for each of them, but there's not variations in costs. We get shortages of the most valued items. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of what we'd expect. There's something missing here. Sorry about that. I don't remember. I think maybe this got cut off somewhere. Now I'm this far into the video, and you know, let's just go back to here and pretend that I ended here, which is where this video should have ended. So anyway, if you can make more sense out of this than I just did, then you know, great. Go ahead and conclude here.